All right, so we're going to talk about human evolution and the ape-man issue. Were there ape men? If so, how do these fit into the biblical worldview? Again, our goal here is to help you understand how scientific findings should be interpreted from the biblical worldview. And this is a critical, critical issue. This issue, perhaps more than any other, convinced a great many Christians that evolution must be true. There are a lot of Christians that accept evolution, but this is the one that convinced them the whole big picture of evolution must be true. They might have been able to accept some, but when they saw credible evidence that humans have evolved from ape-like ancestors, I mean, if we've evolved from apes, then that whole theory of evolution must be true. This was the thing that convinced a great many people. When they saw critical evidence of human evolution, that convinced them that evolution must be true. And it's unfortunate. This is such a hot topic. The issue of human evolution is such a hot topic in the debate about evolution, the debate about worldviews, that any discovery, no matter how minor of a discovery related to human evolution, makes its way into the popular media almost immediately. Front page stuff are discoveries related to human evolution. The problem with that is the populace as a whole tends to consider popular media sources of news very credible. And they're going to assume anything that is published in a popular media source like this must be factual. But oftentimes these findings are discredited later or overturned, but that the retraction will never be on the front page. Instead, it's back there on page 50, you know, in the fine print somewhere in the back. But it's been these kind of reports that have convinced a great many Christians that evolution must be true. And it's just kind of sad. So we want to try to give you some answers there and help you clear up a lot of that for you. Evolution is taught as a matter-of-fact terminology today in public schools. This is a quote from Prentice Hall Biology, one of the most widely used biology textbooks used in public schools today. And they talk about human evolution as if it's just a matter of fact. It happened, that's it, there's no debate. They say humans and other primates evolved from a common ancestor that lived more than 65 million years ago. Between 6 and 7 million years ago, the hominoid line gave rise to a branch that ultimately led to the ancestors and closest relatives of modern humans. Matter of fact, it happened, that's the way it is, it's not theoretical, there's no debate about it. They place humans as just another primate. We are taxonomically classified as a primate. We're an ape, that's what we are to the scientific world. They consider us just one of another step in an evolutionary lineage of these ancient primates. The question is, can we reconcile this view with the Bible? Can we reconcile this view with the Bible? That is one of our big challenges. How do we resolve these conflicts that exist between science and the Bible? The Bible's very clear that God created humans and created us in his own image. But there are a lot of Christians that accept evolution, and they believe the Bible, people we would call theistic evolutionists. There's a lot of theistic evolutionists, people that believe science, and they believe the Bible, and then they try to reconcile these somehow. But if we want to know the truth, if we want to know the true history of the world, if we want to know truly what has happened, we must interpret scientific findings ourselves, consistent with the biblical worldview. We don't let a scientist who is an atheist, who's trying their best to explain our world through purely natural processes, the rigid philosophical naturalism, we can't let them interpret scientific findings, accept their interpretation as if it's fact, and then look to the Bible to see how we can twist the scripture around so it's not in conflict. But unfortunately, that's exactly what a great many people do. Your theistic evolutionists in particular have accepted scientific interpretations of their findings, and then are looking to see how they can twist the scripture around so it's not in conflict. And that's the case here as well. This issue brings up, for people that believe in evolution, that have accepted human evolution as it's currently taught by your public institutions and scientists, what they have to deal with issues like Adam. How do you deal with Adam? Was Adam a real man? There's actually two ways that they try to reconcile the existence of Adam from an evolutionary point of view. One is to just consider that Adam was not a real man. The name Adam means man, and there are a lot of people that just say well, Adam was not a real man. That was just a story that was told to help us understand human nature and how God interacts with humans. So just a story. Adam was not a real man. It's all allegorical, that whole story. That's one way that a lot of people try to eliminate this conflict. The other is to assume that God created humans from an ape-like ancestor, that he initiated the Big Bang, maybe started life here on Earth, and then evolution took its course. And once primates reached a stage of development, then he came down and maybe enhanced them cognitively at that point, breathed the breath of life into them, gave them a soul. That's one of the ways people resolve this issue, is by either saying Adam was not a real man or that God created him from some ape-like ancestor. But for the former, that Adam was, and this is a popular view, a very popular view, that is even taught in many of our Christian universities today, that Adam was not a real man. But if Adam was not a real man, you're on a slippery slope there, because the Bible gives this genealogical record, a chronology of the various ages of the early patriarchs. If Adam was not a real man, who is the first real man? That's a really slippery slope. When does the Bible become real? If it wasn't real in Genesis 1, when does it become real? Genesis 2, Genesis 3? The history in the Bible progresses rapidly. You have Genesis 1 through 3 are the creation story. Genesis 6 through 9 are the flood. Abram enters the picture in Genesis 10, Table of Nations, Tower of Babel in Genesis 11. I mean, the history progresses quickly. When does the Bible become real? When does the history in the Bible become real if it's not with Genesis 1? Personally, for people trying to reconcile the Bible with what scientists are teaching today, again, we can't accept their interpretations and reconcile that with the Bible. We must interpret scientific findings ourselves to be consistent with the biblical worldview. That is absolutely key. A key to understanding how to resolve these conflicts. Jesus himself speaks to these things. He said, "The people honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as their doctrines the precepts of man." We can't accept the teachings of scientists who have rejected the biblical worldview as doctrine. And unfortunately, that's what people do. They accept these things as absolute fact. Christ himself gave to equip the people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. We have to guard ourselves. We have to guard ourselves from false teachings. So I'm going to take you on a bit of a tour of history of human evolution evidence. Evidence that's been presented as it's currently accepted, evidence from the past, as a way of kind of a painting a picture here for you and hopefully encouraging you to be more skeptical of this kind of scientific information. We're going to start with Nebraska Man. Nebraska Man was discovered in western Nebraska, as the name implies, in the year 1922. Media reports of Nebraska Man flooded the classroom. It was used as evidence in the Scopes trial. Nebraska Man was. Notice the illustration here from the Illustrated London News. You can get a lot of information, apparently, from very little evidence because they did not have a complete skeleton to know what Nebraska Man looked like. They did not have a complete skull. They did not have even a jawbone in Nebraska Man. But look how much information they got about Nebraska Man having none of that. All they found was a single tooth. But look at all the information they got about Nebraska Man. Not only did they know what Nebraska Man looked like, but what his very fetching wife over there looked like as well from that one tooth, apparently. However, by 1927, several years later, a full investigation of Nebraska Man was finally undertaken, and it turned out to be neither an ape nor a man. The tooth turned out to belong to a pig, an extinct peccary. Tooth belonged to. But this is not an isolated incident. This, in fact, has happened over and over and over again. Scientists have done this very thing. Not long ago, in 1983, a dolphin's rib was put forth as a human collarbone. It turned out they put forth as a bone from an ancient hominid, and after investigation, it turned out it was a rib from a dolphin. Tim White says, Tim White, the person I'm quoting from here, actually called the discovery Flipperpithecus, because his dolphin. He says a 5 million-year-old piece of bone that was thought to be a collarbone of an ape-like, of a human-like creature is actually part of a dolphin's rib. He expresses his concern over this kind of thing. He says the problem with a lot of anthropologists is that they want so much to find a hominid that any scrap of bone becomes a hominid bone. He's an anthropologist at the University of California. But again, there have been many of these, not just the pig and the dolphin I've mentioned already, but in addition to that, an alligator has been put forth, a horse, a bear, an elephant, and a donkey. At some point, fragments of bone from all of these has been asserted to be evidence of human evolution. Nigel Locke stated that in the London Times that few sciences produce such abundant returns from so few fragments of facts as paleontology. And that is true. Any little fragment, and you have found a new human species, some new information that helps us understand human evolution a little better. The next example I'll give you is that of Piltdown Man, who was discovered in a gravel pit in Piltdown, England in the year 1911 by Charles Dawson. This is actually a staged photo of Charles Dawson in the gravel pits in Piltdown, England, where they had discovered Piltdown Man. A year later, 1912, it was announced that Darwin's theory had been proved true in the New York Times. Darwin's theory proved true. From 1912 to 1953, Piltdown Man reigned supreme as evidence of human evolution, as proof of human evolution. Scores of books, pamphlets, articles were published about Piltdown Man for 40 years. It was the evidence used to support human evolution. But a full 40 years later, it was revealed to be a fraud, an obvious fraud. The teeth had been filed down to make them look more human-like, and the bones had been treated to give them the appearance of age. And according to records, the filing was so obvious on the teeth that it is said that people had to have willfully ignored that fact. They willfully ignored that fact. They just went ahead and accepted and used that as evidence, even though they knew there was something terribly wrong with it. But probably one of the most convincing pieces of scientific information that convinced people of human evolution was not a bone, was not a fossil. It was, in fact, an illustration, a diagram. Propaganda convinced more people than anything else that human evolution must be true. This diagram right here, called the March of Progress, is arguably the most recognizable scientific illustration of all time. Of all time. It was published in a Time Life book series called Early Man. It was a poster that, when pulled out, 5 pages long, formed this poster you see here. The poster was sent out as a publicity tool to promote the book series to universities, schools, libraries, museums across the globe. As a result, the poster found its way into classrooms and libraries everywhere. Even Stephen Jay Gould remarked about the diagram. He said the March of Progress is the canonical representation of evolution, the one picture immediately grasped and viscerally understood by all. Stephen Jay Gould, probably the most popular evolutionist of our day. Viscerally understood by all. We can see the evidence, the proof of human evolution right there in that diagram. The March of Progress has been reproduced countless times over the years. Parodied countless times over the years. You start looking for this diagram now and you're going to see it everywhere. Lots of parodies. The problem with the diagram, though, is that it was knowingly fictitious. Knowingly fictitious. It was known at the time this was produced, this includes both proto-apes and apes, it was known at the time that these apes did not walk upright. The creator of this illustration even acknowledges this in fine print. He said, although proto-apes and apes were quadrupedal, walked on all four, all are shown here standing for comparison. But they're not shown standing. They're shown walking. They're shown, that's why it's called the March of Progress. They're marching. The fact is that there's a significant difference between humans and apes, a significant difference. And the significance is related to the difference in our stance, in the way we walk. Apes, monkeys and apes, are quadrupeds. They walk on all four. When apes walk on the ground, they are what you call knuckle walkers. Their wrists lock into place and they walk on their knuckles. Humans are bipeds. Significant structural differences between the two accommodate these two different kinds of movements. The anatomical differences between apes and humans are largely due to these different forms of movement. The shape of the face, the shape of the pelvis, the shoulder blades themselves, the knees, all different to accommodate bipedal movement in humans. The differences are significant. So what about these ape men then that we tend to see? Again, another version of the March of Progress illustration here, showing some of these supposed ape men. Creation scientists in general would lump these ape men into two groups. And in fact, they belong into two genera, two taxonomic genera. Although there are more species that have been claimed than these. Today, if a scientist can find a little fragment of human bone and can claim that it's a new species, boom, front page kind of discovery there. So they're always claiming they found a new species of human ape men. But then later, usually it's reassigned to one of our existing groups. Nonetheless, you have two genera. The Australopithecines, the genus Australopithecus, collectively referred to as Australopithecines, the creation science community almost unanimously argues that these are just apes, true apes. Not ape men, just apes. The other genus, the genus Homo, includes, of course, us, the Homo sapiens, also includes Homo erectus and the Neanderthals. The creation science community would argue that these are true humans, just humans. I have intentionally overlapped my illustration there across Homo habilis because it's largely argued that Homo habilis is actually a mixture of some ape bones and some human bones. So it's a real ape man. But all of these supposed ape men can be classified as having been created in one of three ways. How do you get an ape man? You do it one of these three ways. One is by mixing together ape and human bones and declare the two to be one individual. Some ape men have been created that way. You can also emphasize the human-like qualities of fossilized apes. And with some creative imagination, you can upgrade the ape to be more human-like. Some have been created that way. And as well, you can emphasize the ape-like qualities of fossilized humans. And with some imagination, you can downgrade your humans and claim that they were more ape-like. They've been done in all of these three ways. So what I want to look at, I want to look at the Australopithecines. We're going to look at Homo erectus, and we're going to look at Neanderthals, and I'm going to try to leave you with an understanding of where these fit. How do we interpret these scientific findings from the biblical worldview? That's our goal. So we're going to start with the Australopithecines, again regarded by the creation community as, by and large, as being just true apes. The poster child of the Australopithecines, everyone might know, Lucy. Called Lucy apparently because after she was discovered, according to reports, they were playing some music in the camp, and the song that was on was the Beatles song Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. Anyone a Beatles fan? No Beatles fan? Lucy in the Sky, Lucy. Oh, I ain't going to sing it. But that's why they call it Lucy, because Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds was blaring over at the camp that night, and someone decided to call it Lucy. Discovered in Ethiopia in 1974. About 40% complete, although missing was very fragmentary. Very fragmentary, missing a lot of important pieces. It has been models of Australopithecus afarensis have been placed in museums across the globe. This is one at the Las Vegas Natural History Museum. Here's another from the Maxwell Museum of Anthropology at the University of New Mexico. A few years ago, they even brought Lucy on tour here in Seattle. It was at the Pacific Science Center. I took my creation apologetics class to tour the Lucy exhibit a few years ago. I teach science here at Cedar Park, but I also offer a semester class on creation apologetics. And that was my class from that year as we went to tour the Lucy exhibit. Very interesting, very interesting observations there. I don't have time to get into it, but I'll mention one. One thing that I found was most interesting. In order to tour Lucy, the Ethiopian government required that they include within the exhibit the history of Ethiopia, which is almost entirely the Christian history of Ethiopia, which I just thought was super cool. You know, walk through there, because, you know, it's all about evolution, and right there in the middle of it, huge historical context of the Christian heritage of Ethiopia, which I thought was very cool. Here's another model. This one's at the Living World exhibit in St. Louis, at the St. Louis Zoo. All of these models, if you'll take note, very human-like hands and feet. Look at the feet and hands on this model. Very human-like. Also note the pensive gaze. What is he pondering? The fate of the Australopithecine? Will she go with me to prom if I ask? I don't know. Will she go? I don't know what he's thinking. The problem with this, when this model was created, it was already known prior to the creation of this model that the Australopithecines did not have hands and feet like this. In their initial discovery, they did not find those. But since then, they have found many other Australopithecus afarensis fossils, and prior to this, they had found enough of the hands and feet to know that they did not look like this, that they were not, they were in fact, their hands and feet were very curved and ape-like. Very curved and ape-like, but in all of these illustrations that you see, completely human-like hands and feet. The most extensive analysis of these was done in 1983 by Jack Stern and Randall Sussman, paleoanthropologists at the State University of New York at Stony Brook, and they have several quotes here for you to emphasize their... Now, they believe Australopithecus afarensis was an ape man, was a transitional form that was evolving into man, but there were several comments here that are notable. They said, the morphological and functional affinities of the hand fossil leads inexorably to an image of suspensory adapted hand, hanging. Surprisingly similar to the hands in the small end of the pygmy chimpanzee to common chimpanzee range. So the hands are even closer to pygmy chimpanzees than they are even regular chimpanzees. They also assert that there is no evidence that any extant living primate has long, curved, heavily muscled hands and feet for any purpose other than to meet the demands of full or part-time arboreal life. They had the hands of the type of apes that live in trees, period. Their shoulder blade is also that of an arboreal ape, sharply angled, whereas humans are vertically oriented. This also indicates that they lived an arboreal lifestyle, what we call a brachiation, hanging from the trees, swinging from the trees. By the year 2000, we also had discovered that their wrists locked into place as all knuckle walkers do. Reported in Nature and Science News. Look at the title of the article in Science News. Is it? Lucy on the ground with knuckles. They say that Lucy had wrists capable of locking the hands in place during knuckle walking. By the year 2000, we'd also learned this. The pelvis of Lucy was very ape-like. Very ape-like. The iliac bone in apes versus humans are completely different. The iliac blade of the human goes front to back, whereas in apes, they flare out laterally. And Lucy had ape-like hips. Stern and Sussman note this as well. They say the fact that the anterior portion of the iliac blade faces laterally in humans but not in chimpanzees is obvious. The marked resemblance of Lucy to chimpanzees is equally obvious. It suggests to us that the mechanism of lateral pelvic balance during bipedalism was closer to that in apes than in humans. So what do you do if you're a paleoanthropologist and your best hope for proof of human evolution has hips that won't allow it to walk upright? You can stand there woefully. Or maybe you can take your fossil and do some reconstructive surgery on it, modify it, and come up with a skeleton that actually will walk upright. Now, it seems like I'm making a joke here, because it's a cartoon. But in fact, this is exactly what someone has done. Dr. Owen Lovejoy, in a 1994 PBS Nova series, sees the hip of Lucy as being very problematic, very chimp-like, a quadrupedal type of bones in the pelvis, and so he decides to do something about it. Watch this.
We needed Owen Lovejoy's expertise again, because the evidence wasn't quite adding up. The knee looked human, but the shape of her hip didn't. Superficially, her hip resembled a chimpanzee's, which meant that Lucy couldn't possibly have walked like a modern human. But Lovejoy noticed something odd about the way the bones had been fossilized.
When I put the two parts of the pelvis together that we had, this part of the pelvis has pressed so hard and so completely into this one that it caused it to be broken into a series of individual pieces which were then fused together.
So it looks like an ape's hip bone, a chimp's hip bone, but he figured it couldn't be that way, so it must have been broken and refused together during fossilization. So watch what he does.
This has caused the two bones, in fact, to fit together so well that they're in an anatomically impossible position.
To walk upright.
The perfect fit was an illusion that made Lucy's hip bone seem to flare out like a chimp's. But all was not lost. Lovejoy decided he could restore the pelvis to its natural shape. He didn't want to tamper with the original, so he made a copy in plaster.
Look how much he's cutting away. Mm-hmm.
He cut the damaged pieces out and put them back together the way they were before Lucy died. It was a tricky job, but after taking the kink out of the pelvis, it all fit together perfectly, like a three-dimensional jigsaw puzzle.
Like a big hole right there.
As a result, the angle of the hip looks nothing like a chimp's, but a lot like ours.
The skull is also very ape-like, and we've known about this since the very beginning. For decades, we've known what the skull of Australopithecines afarensis looked like. They have the typical shovel face of an ape. Human faces are very flat. Because we stand upright, we need to be able to see down, face is very flat. That's one of the most distinguishing differences between ape and human, is the difference between the shovel face and our human's very flat face. But all aspects of the Australopithecus skull is very ape-like. The point where the spinal cord connects to the skull is also much more similar to chimps than in humans. The position of the ear canal, the bones of the inner ear, are all much more similar to apes than in humans. And people have noted these problems for decades. World-renowned scientists have discussed this with much trouble. For example, Ashley Montague is a British anthropologist who taught at Harvard, Princeton, Rutgers, University of California, New York University. He says, and this is back from 1958, the skull form of all Australopithecines is extremely ape-like. The Australopithecines show too many specialized and ape-like characteristics to be either the direct ancestor of man or to the line that led to man. Lord Zuckerman was a professor of anatomy at Birmingham University and is the chief scientific advisor to the British government. He said in 1970, "I am totally unpersuaded," he says. "Almost always when I've tried to check the anatomical claims of which the status of Australopithecus is based, I have ended in failure." The Australopithecine skull is in fact so overwhelmingly simian as opposed to human that the contrary position could be equated to an assertion that black is white. What more definitive statement could you have? The skull is definitely ape-like, definitely ape-like. But when you're an illustrator, when you're trying to prove to the populace that humans have evolved from ape and you have a skull that's very ape-like, what do? They emphasize the human-like qualities of an ape-like skull, and with some creative imagination, you could upgrade your ape to become more human. And this is what they do. Look at this illustration that was created for National Geographic in 1996. The artist intentionally modified it to make it look more human-like than it was. Face had been flattened out significantly, and as well, you can see other features like the whites of the eyes. You may have never noticed, but no ape has whites in their eyes. And the illustrator, the person who made this diagram, admits this. Listen to what he says. He says, "I wanted to get a human soul into this ape-like face to indicate something about where she was headed." So it's not an exact model. You know, they know it's not an exact model. It's an ape-like face, and he wanted to get a human-like soul into it to show something about where they think it was headed. Intentionally misleading people with the evidence. This is what they're doing. Australopithecines are very ape-like. Numerous characteristics are only ape-like, just are not seen in humans. Charles Oxnard, one more quote before we move on. Charles Oxnard is arguably the world's foremost expert on computerized analysis of bones. He says that they have been completely removed from human lineage. He says they are now irrevocably removed from a place in the evolution of human bipedalism, possibly from a place in a group any closer to humans than to African apes, and certainly from any place in the direct human lineage. He says they've been removed. An analysis has concluded that we are removing these, but I think he's a little naive to make such a statement, because they will never remove evidence until they have new evidence to take its place. They will keep what they have and keep touting it as proof of their view until they have better evidence to take its place, no matter how many problems there are with it. And there are many. Australopithecines remain as their leading contender of a human ape man. Let's move on. I want to look at Neanderthals, Homo erectus, and try to give you a little bit of understanding as to how these fit in the biblical worldview. Here's one of the original drawings of Neanderthals, shown right here. Neanderthals were found in the Neander Valley in near Dusseldorf, Germany in 1856, believed to look very ape-like, believed to have lived 600,000 to all the way up to like 30,000 years ago. They inhabited the area shown in green here on this map. This is where we have found Neanderthal fossils. It is just south, they lived just south of what's called the 50th parallel north. They lived during the Ice Age, which crazy scientists believe was caused by the global flood. So they lived just south of the ice advance, right there. The glacial advance moved right down to that very point, so they lived just south of the glaciers that had formed during this ice age. The most significant difference between them and what we would call modern humans is that they have a thick a brow ridge. They have a really thick brow ridge, and they have thick bones, not just in their skull, but everywhere. What we call robust bones. They have thick, robust bones. They're also kind of stocky, short extremities, but the most significant difference, what we call robust bones. Thought to look very ape-like in the beginning, look what they think they look like now. This is a reconstruction that's in the Neanderthal Museum in Mettmann, Germany. Believed to look very human-like now. Eric Tinkus, an anthropologist at Washington University and an expert in Neanderthal biology, says they're fully human. He said, detailed comparison of Neanderthal skeleton remains with those of modern humans have shown that there is nothing in Neanderthal anatomy that conclusively indicates locomotor, manipulative, intellectual, or linguistic abilities inferior to those of modern humans. V. Sodera has written three books on human anatomy and surgical techniques. He says, despite their stocky body build, their stocky skull shape, there is no hard evidence to say that Neanderthals were in any way inferior intellectually to modern man. They are known to have made sophisticated flint tools, to have built huts out of animal skins, and had control of fire. They also buried their dead. We have found Neanderthals buried with trophies from hunts. We know they were big game hunters. We've found them buried with mammoth tusks. We've also found them buried alongside modern humans. They have found humans and Neanderthals buried right there together. Marvin Lubinow, who wrote the book Bones of Contention. If I was to recommend any book on human evolution, it would be Marvin Lubinow's Bones of Contention. Marvin Lubinow details the findings of Neanderthals very well. He says most anthropologists recognize burial as a very human act and a very religious act. But he says the strongest evidence that Neanderthals were fully human and of our own species is that at four sites, Neanderthals and modern humans were found buried together. That's very significant. They're buried together. And there's some insight we can gain from that. A couple more pictures of Neanderthals. Again, this one's from the Mettmann, Germany Neanderthal Museum. And another of the famous Gibraltar child that was discovered in 1926. once thought to look very ape-like, but those initial reconstructions were discovered to be wrong. Now we realize that the Neanderthals were fully human. Brain capacity even slightly larger than normal than ours. They used jewelry, musical instruments, lots of cave paintings. Lots and lots of cave paintings of Neanderthals have now been uncovered, and we know they buried their dead. But in the past, they have manipulated this data as well. Jack Cuozzo, who wrote the book Buried Alive, which I believe I have a copy of this and a copy of Jack Cuozzo's book in the back there. Jack Cuozzo, a retired orthodontist, and while retired, he managed to get into the museums over in France and Germany with a portable X-ray machine and X-ray Neanderthal skulls. Because of his credentials, he took letters of introduction with him and was able to get permission from the museums that are housing these Neanderthal skulls to do X-rays of them. And while he was there doing his work, he found this illustration in a souvenir counter at the museum in Berlin. And as a retired orthodontist, he noticed something significantly wrong with this diagram. And that was that the jaw is way out of place. Way out of place. A full 30 millimeters over an inch out of socket. The jaw is supposed to fit right there into that fossa, that little groove right there. But instead has been pulled way forward. And he reported that he has seen anthropologists doing this. The two most commonly found bones of these ancient hominids is the skull cap and the jaw. Because very heavy bones in the jaw, very heavy bones in the skull cap. But if that's all you have, then you have to decide how this jaw fits with this skull cap. Where does it fit? Because you don't have anything but the cap and the jaw. Where does it fit? If it's out forward, it looks ape-like. If you bring it back so that it's flush, then it's very human-like. And these anthropologists will just sit there and look at it. Oh, let me see. Oh, yeah, this is where it fits. If you put it back in its right place, though, it looks much more human-like. Again, this is a Neanderthal skull there on the left. But with the jaw put back in its right place, you got a flat face. However, if you want to emphasize ape-like qualities of a fossilized human and make, then that's one of the things you do. You just reposition the jaw, move the jaw forward, tend to model it more like the ape shovel face, and there you go. I found this on Wikipedia, just happened to be looking around and found this. This is actually a Homo erectus skull, but on it, the jaw is also completely out of socket, moved way forward. It's supposed to be back here. The fossa is right here. Same thing of Homo erectus. By just positioning the jaw out front, you make it look more ape-like. So let's take a brief look at Homo erectus. Homo erectus was first discovered in 1891 by Eugene Dubois in the Java Islands in Indonesia. So the first discovery was called Java Man. These illustrations were made when they had only found a skull cap and a femur. But notice how much information they got from that skull cap and the femur. Got very much a shovel-like face. These illustrations are for 1922. Before they had found anything else but a skull cap. Eugene Dubois, this is an actual photo, an illustration that was in Eugene Dubois' publication. The skull cap, he found a single skull cap, a femur, just two views of the femur, and a single tooth. It was contested almost immediately whether or not the femur belonged to the skull cap because the skull cap was robust. Very thick skull cap. Bone were very thick in the skull cap, but the bones of the femur were normal human-like bones. They weren't the robust kind of bones that were in the skull cap. So it was argued from the very beginning whether they belonged to the same individual. Nonetheless, a few years later, the Peking man was discovered. This is the entrance to the cave system where Peking man was discovered outside Beijing, which was originally called Peking. So thus the name Peking man. Look at the statue, this big sculpture that's outside of the cave system of Peking Man. I have to think that if that poor fellow that inhabited that cave once upon a time came back and saw that monument outside of his cave, he'd think, God, man, these people were worshiping me like I was some kind of a god back there. I mean, what do you think, this poor fellow, if he came back and saw that big thing outside of his cave? Well, what they found was six skull caps in this cave system outside of Beijing. There's an interesting story behind it all. I can't go into it, but all of these are replicas. The original skull caps were lost during World War II. Apparently, just a brief reason. When Japan was invading, they decided they needed to move these to some kind of safer location, and they transferred the skull caps into the hands of some U.S. servicemen. And at some point, while they were transporting these down to where they were supposed to meet up with the ship, they were captured, the skull caps were lost, the U.S. servicemen ended up in an internment camp, and no one knows what happened to the skull cap. But as recently as 2005, they were trying to revive interest to find them. Nonetheless, and I've heard a lot of criticisms of that they weren't real. Oh, they were lost, you know. But at this point, I think we can reasonably say that these people that are just classified as Homo erectus did exist. We have found them all over the eastern side of Africa, up in here into Europe, and to parts of Asia. The red dots there show you exactly where Homo erectus fossils have been found. Much like Neanderthals, the biggest difference between them and modern humans is the robust bone development, very thick bones. But they also had that thick brow ridge that was typical of Neanderthals. They also had a very flat forehead, very tapered back forehead, not much of a forehead, and also didn't have much of a chin, a protruding chin. Otherwise, there's a significant similarity between them and Neanderthals, and in fact, a similarity between both of those and modern humans. The most significant difference was thought originally to be cranial capacity, that the cranial capacity of Homo erectus was smaller than humans, and it was thought that that was very significant. But very recently, a study was done of several modern human populations to compare their cranial capacity size with that of the Homo erectus fossils they had found to see if there in fact was any significance to it. So in 1994, a substantial study was done, and these researchers concluded that no, it was not significant. They say now that comparable data is available, it appears that if Homo sapiens includes all the people alive today in the world, their ancestors in the late Pleistocene, and those we refer to as archaic Homo sapiens, then vault thickness cannot be used to distinguish Homo erectus from Homo sapiens. Even the one main characteristic that they thought would distinguish us, vault thickness itself, could not be used to distinguish them. And in 2008, another discovery was made that showed that their skull size, the cranial capacity, was itself well within the range of modern humans. They actually found a pelvis, Homo erectus pelvis, that allowed them to compare that with modern Homo sapiens, and they confirmed that not only vault thickness, the thickness of the skull, but the cranial capacity as well, both clearly within line of modern humans. So, I'm going to give you one more piece of trivia, which I thought was interesting, and so you may as well. I don't know if you'll find it interesting or not, but I thought it was. Okay, one of the significant tools that they have found associated with Homo erectus was what they call a hand axe. And this map shows you all the places where these hand axes have been found. And there's actually a monument of one outside of Heritage Park in England, this hand axe. They look like this. And they're called hand axes because they're roughly the size of a hand, and it has been largely presumed that that's how they were used. They were held in hand and used as a hand axe. But there's a great uncertainty about what these actually were. But they have found them broadly over these areas that were occupied by both Homo erectus and Neanderthals. They have found these hand axes. The reason why their use is debated at this point is because most of them are found to be beveled to a point all the way around. So they're sharpened to a point all the way around. But if you were making a tool to be used in your hand, you would definitely round off the end that you were going to be holding in your hand. Yet they're sharpened all the way around. So it's been argued that they may actually be the remains of a core that was used to create like arrowheads and things. You'd use one rock and hit it with another rock to try to knock chips off to make into sharpened tools. So it's thought that maybe it was just these were left behind cores of that. Marvin Lubinow in Bones of Contention asserted, and I looked this up and found this elsewhere, that they were a hunting tool that was actually thrown at prey. And they called it, called on Wikipedia, a super frisbee. Someone had called it a super frisbee. But Marvin Lubinow argued that this might be the source of the discus that has been a long-standing Olympic event. Most of these competitions were based on either hunting or war types of feats that people would do, and that he argued that that may be how that thing was thrown at animals. So they would throw them at them when they were like at watering holes and try to knock one of them down or something. Anyway, there's a little bit of debate about that. I can say, interesting piece of trivia, I thought, but I don't know, something to think about. Okay, I want to try to give you the final piece of this story and help you understand how these fit into the biblical worldview. Who were these people? Like I kind of alluded to before, it is largely asserted by most of what we would call the young earth creation science community that these were post-flood humans, humans that lived after the flood. Marvin Lubinow, again in Bones of Contention, makes this assertion. He says, my own conclusion is that Homo erectus and Neanderthals were actually the same. Homo erectus merely on the lower end with regard to size of a continuum that includes both Homo erectus, Homo sapiens, and Neanderthals. The range of cranial capacities for fossil humans is in line with the range of cranial capacities in modern humans. He actually shows, you won't be able to read this diagram, but he actually shows by a detailed analysis of fossil discoveries that what the fossils of what we would call modern Homo sapiens have actually been found alongside and actually predating all Neanderthals and all Homo erectus, and in fact comparable to or contemporary with your Australopithecines as well. So they have found modern Homo sapiens that predate Neanderthals, modern Homo sapiens that predate Homo erectus, and in fact are in line contemporary with your Australopithecines as well. So very inconsistent with their assertions that Homo erectus has eventually evolved into Homo sapiens. Peter Line in the Journal of Creation argues basically the same point, stating that if Neanderthals and Homo erectus are actually true humans, as we believe that they are, as is asserted, then that what that causes is what he describes as an unbridgeable morphological gap between your Australopithecines and humans. Just like we said, there are true apes, like your Australopithecines, and then true humans, and between which there are no ape men. No ape men at all. Peter Line also offers some explanations for the differences in the Neanderthal and Homo erectus anatomy, specifically the robust bone growth that we see in the skull and the jaw. He offers several explanations for these. He offers a greater genetic diversity as a possible source for the differences, again, between modern Homo sapiens and Homo erectus Neanderthals. Also, living under particularly harsh environmental conditions. They lived during the post-flood ice age, very, very harsh conditions, could explain some anatomical differences there. Dietary habits. Anyone that lived immediately after the flood would find it real hard to find vegetables. You know, Earth's surface destroyed. It would have taken potentially a few centuries to develop enough good topsoil to where you started having, some good farming going on. So nutrient deficiencies, it's been reported that like the rickets, a nutrient deficiency, is that vitamin C deficiency causing the rickets, something like that? Would have caused some deformations of the skeletal system in particular. Stresses of particular biomechanical forces. He mentions stresses of particular biomechanical forces. What he means by this is the tendency of people to use their jaws and teeth as tools, and the changes that this would cause to the skeletal structure. So, like, you're a Homo erectus or Neanderthal, and you don't have your vice grips with you, or your big, vice, can't lock your stuff down, and you need to make some stuff. What do? You put it in your teeth, and you pull on it, if you're trying to make strips of leather out of a big hide or something, you put it in your teeth, and you start tripping it away. And unknown to most people, when you put stress on your body, your skeletal system is changed, it's remodeled, to accommodate that additional stress. Your skeletal system is constantly remodeling itself. You have cells that are eating away at your bone, and different cells lay down new bone. And they're constantly being remodeled to match the particular stresses, the needs that you place upon them. You've probably heard, people that are like big, way overweight, say that they're just big because they're big boned. If you're, I'm not big, I'm just big boned. Well, it's true in a way, but they're not big because they're big boned. They're big boned because they're big. If you put on a lot of weight, your bones will be remodeled and strengthened to accommodate that additional weight. Or look at someone, for example, like look at someone like a professional rock climber. If you ever have a chance to look at the hands of a professional rock climber, you'll see additional bone development in their hands due to the stresses that they place upon them. So he suggests that as a way of explaining some of the robust development in the skull. But and he also mentions pathology, diseases, like the rickets, and we mentioned nutrient deficiency or other diseases. But the most compelling to me is this one, longevity. Longevity. Remember that after the flood, people continued to live very old ages for a period of time. Before the flood, they lived to be like 800-900 years old. And it appears that one of the intended consequences of the flood was to reduce the life expectancy, the lifespan of humans. If you read, go back and read Genesis 6 through 9. When God says, I'm going to destroy the world by flood, just before he says that, the verse just before he says that, he says, man shall not live forever, for he shall live, but be 120 years. He said, my soul shall not contend with man forever, but his years are 120 years. Something like that. I can't remember the exact. But he says, man will live only to 120 years. I'm going to destroy the world by flood. And it appears from that verse, my interpretation of that was the intended consequence of the flood. Was to read one of the intended consequences, destroy the world that had become wicked, the human race had become wicked in those days. But it's interesting that Moses himself, and you look at the longevity, this is a graph showing the people that lived after the flood. Moses himself died at exactly 120, but it tapered off right about to that point, was tapering down to 120 about the time Moses lived. Even today, the medical max human lifespan is 120 years, exactly. It's interesting in comparison, but so think about what would a person's skeleton look like? What would their skull and jaw look like if they're 400 years old? I mean, it offers a good explanation for these very robust bones that we see amongst the Homo erectus and Neanderthals, okay? But I want to give you a little more on this. The theories regarding the evolution of these, the Neanderthals and Homo erectus in particular, have changed dramatically through time. And there's another interesting tidbit here that I want to give you. I don't know how well you can see, not very well, I don't think, from way over there. These are four different diagrams to show how Neanderthal and Homo erectus were believed to the evolutionary relationship between these and modern Homo sapiens, how that worked. So I'm going to try to read this to you if I can read it. Australopithecines down here. In that 1955, Australopithecines evolved into Homo erectus, and then Homo erectus evolved into Neanderthals and Homo sapiens, 1955. By 1967, they said that Homo erectus had evolved into Neanderthals and then Homo sapiens, but that Homo erectus wasn't involved there. By 1971, these are the Australopithecines, Homo erectus and Neanderthals did not evolve into Homo sapiens, all the way over here. And then by 1980, it changed again so that they viewed Homo erectus evolving into both Homo sapiens and Neanderthals, and at this point in time, in 1980, Neanderthals were considered to be a Homo sapien. They were actually given the taxonomic name Homo sapiens Neanderthalus in the 1980s. But now that's changed again. They're considered a separate species from modern humans, and it is actually widely regarded that they're not related to us at all. Neither are Homo erectus. I want to show you something. The original theory, okay, I'm going to walk you through this diagram as well. So, Homo erectus is believed to live about a million years ago, evolved about a million years ago, and over time evolved into Homo sapiens up about 100,000 years ago. Okay, this is the general timeline involved that they believe is involved with the evolution of Homo erectus to Homo sapiens. Okay, the original view. And remember, we have found Homo erectus in both Africa, parts of Europe, parts of Asia, even down in some of the islands of around Australia. So the original theory called the multi-regional view held that that Homo erectus that evolved in Africa had migrated to these various regions like Europe and Asia and then Australia, or this is the Australia and the islands around Australia referred collectively as Oceania. But that these Homo erectus evolved in these various regions into Homo sapiens. because we find Homo erectus there, and today we find modern Homo sapiens there, and the original view was that the Homo erectus populations in these areas had evolved into the Homo sapiens that are in these areas. That was the original view, and makes very good sense. But look what they did. The out of Africa theory changed all this. The out of Africa theory holds that the Homo erectus in Africa continued to evolve into Homo sapiens, but these Homo erectus populations that we find in Europe, Asia, and in Oceania did not. But something happened to them, and that's debated about what that it was. Did they go extinct or something? And then they believe that the Homo sapiens that eventually evolved in Africa migrated out of Africa into these various regions, so that the Homo sapiens that live there now are not related to the Homo erectus that we have found there. Very weird, right? I mean, it's weird. Who was it? Was it Lubinow? I think it was Lubinow. Suggested that the main motivation for changing this theory was the racial overtones that had kind of haunted evolution for so many years. Justifications of racism to groups like the Australian Aborigines and such were based on this, that they just had not quite slightly evolved as much. But if all of them are related to the same Homo sapiens population that migrated into those areas, no problem, okay? But the out of Africa theory has been bolstered, has been supported significantly by what is called mitochondrial Eve studies. You probably heard about this, mitochondrial genetic analysis of modern humans have produced a migratory map that looks like this. So they check, most of your DNA, you probably know, is in the nucleus of your cell, but you also have DNA in the mitochondria, one of the little organelles, and the chloroplast. So it has their own DNA there, and they don't undergo recombination events during the formation of sex cells like all of your other DNA does. So it's a stable, what we call genome. Nonetheless, what they do is they compare the mitochondrial sequences of people here with those elsewhere, and this has been generated by looking for mutations. So this group over here has a couple of mutations, and then this group over here has those same mutations but a couple more, and then this group over here has those but a couple more, and so they've developed these migratory maps from mitochondrial studies, okay? But there's something significant to this that I'm getting to, okay? So mitochondrial Eve data. Now look at this map. This is an overlay that shows not only the Neanderthals and Homo erectus, but the modern Homo sapiens that are believed to have migrated out of Africa, replacing all them or something. The yellow being the Homo erectus populations, the orange being the Neanderthal populations, and then the red being the modern Homo sapiens. Okay, so if we're right about this, all of these people, these Neanderthals and Homo erectus, are people that lived after the flood, okay? And are the Homo erectus Neanderthals are the people after the flood that lived to be much older lifespans, okay? And the reason why we find something like Neanderthals buried with a modern Homo sapiens is because you have a 400-year-old guy buried right alongside some youngster, some 40-year-old person. No big deal, okay? But I want you to see something. One of the most interesting aspects about this is that this radiation event really triggers in right there, where there is a biblical reference to the Tower of Babel. Okay, if we're right about this, that this is what we're looking at here, our post-flood migrations, I want you to look at something. Now, a long-standing view that had, I don't know what the real basis was for it, other than the fact that the name Babylon sound really close to the name Babel, held by some people that Babel was in Iraq between the Tigris and Euphrates River. I don't know how close you can see that little green circle I painted in there. But if Babel was a Babylon, that's where it would be. But few people regard that as being valid. That it seems to be just a similarity between Babylon and Babel. I'm not sure how much more went into it than that. But more people seem to regard it as being in northeastern Syria in what's called the Upper Khabar River Triangle. So they believe that the Tower of Babel is actually located right here. I'm going to paint it another circle. Watch this. That right there, right at that intersection, where humans are believed to have radiated from, existed the Tower of Babel. I mean, that's pretty cool, don't you think? I thought it was seriously cool to see biblical history and these scientific findings overlapping so well. But again, we need to interpret these scientific findings ourselves. This is the key. If we want to know the true history of the world, if we want to know what really has happened here, we can't let an atheist interpret these scientific findings and give us their view and dates and these kind of things. We need to interpret these scientific findings ourselves. And if we use the biblical history to do so, we can find some very consistent and amazing parallels between the two accounts, right? I mean, that's pretty cool stuff. So stand firm in your belief in the Bible. Trust in the Bible as authoritative, because within that book resides more history than can be found in entire libraries elsewhere. Bible is a history book, and it contains that history of these very early periods of the earth that can be found nowhere else. We can trust in the Bible as authoritative. We need to do so. Stand firm. All right, let me go ahead and get our guys to come up here. We're going to go ahead and open it up for some question and answers. Before we do so, we need to take up a quick offering. Like I say, you use the envelopes in your seat backs there if you want these. The monies will get come down front, and I'll pray for us real quick. Use the envelopes if you want. The money is given to Cedar Park, earmarked for this specific program. Like I said, I'm not taking an honorarium for tonight, but we have Brian Thomas come from ICR next month, and we need to be able to support him well as well. So Tracy's coming on down too. Let me just pray for us. Father, we are so thankful that we have your word, and we wanted just to lift up our love and our praise to you, that you have so cared for us, that you've created this wonderful place for us, this wonderful world with all its amazing designs, that beauty that we enjoy and love every day. We thank you that you created this place for us, but we also thank you that you love us enough to have guided us and protect us by leaving us your word through your prophets and through your apostles, Father. We are grateful that you have made yourself known to us, Father. Father, we just take a moment to praise you, and Father, we lift up this offering to you and ask that you use these monies in your service, Father. We offer up Cedar Park to you and ask that you bless this ministry, the school that they have going. Bless this ministry. Bless the school. Bring students into this school, Father. Let its classrooms grow and burst to the seams, Father. We ask for your blessing, Father. We just praise your name. We glorify and honor you. In Christ's name, amen. All right, so, Tracy, I am going to need someone to come down with the mic. Tracy, you're okay. Bill, would you grab the mic from Kevin back there and be my mic guy for the question and answers? Would you mind doing that? A little out of sequence here. I'm Norman of the MC doing the whole mic running around thing, and we're having to go a different set, so bear with us. I just wanted to open it up, give you a little bit of an opportunity to ask some questions. Not that I can answer everything, and if you don't stay exactly on topic, that's okay too. Because frequently these kind of things, there are other burning questions that people might have. Not that I have all the answers, but let the mic come around and he'll get to you. Bill, I think we got one right down here.
Now, Michael Behe, in his book, Darwin's Black Box, mm-hmm. in 1995, mm-hmm. I want to say was the first complete compendium of genetic research to that point. DNA disproved the whole idea of evolution anyway, because how can these 22 pairs of nucleotides actually one of them change and give rise to another species?
I mean, we now know that DNA is information. I mean, that's the biggest, one of the biggest challenges for evolutionists to explain right there. How did information come about through some kind of purely natural process? Everything we know about information says that information comes from only one place, an intelligent mind. When we found that information within cells, we should have allowed our experience to inform our conclusion. Well, if information only comes from an intelligent mind, we have information within the cell. The cell must have come from an intelligent mind. You would think experience would, and our reason would cause us to reach such a conclusion, but they are... You know, They're adamant with their view that, but one, in my opinion, one of the most ludicrous aspects of Darwinism, of their theory of evolution, what we now would call neo-Darwinism, lumping genetics into that, is that all of that information, all of this incredible design would ultimately come about through random mutations. Randomly changing information is not going to make more information. It destroys information. And we know that the human genome has degraded and is degrading. These diseases that we're experiencing that are due to mutations of God's creation, the fall has ultimately led to a destruction of what he created. But yeah, the existence of information. Mutations as a source of that information, it's just ludicrous.
Based on Behe's book, if you ever read it, one of the parts of one of the chapters was he gives a number of reasons why they don't believe it. And I think number four was number six was because they don't want to.
They don't want to. Yeah, that's good. Thanks, Bill.
I'm kind of intrigued by your Neanderthal explanation, but I'm a little unclear on some of the points. I'd like to be more clear if I ever use the argument. What I understand is that the Neanderthal skeleton is probably 400 years old because of all this, and it's been misshapen by all the stresses and whatnot of living 400 years. But what are there two? Are you saying there are two side-by-side species, sapien and Neanderthal, or they're just the same species and one lived longer?
I think the same species, just different groups. I mean, if today, if you look at races, you can see some significant structural differences, slight difference, overall average size differences between two, for example, you know, regions versus, you know, you can see some significant differences. It was Noah's three sons that fostered all the nations that followed. And what you might just be looking at is, you know, the Neanderthals, possibly from one of his sons, Homo erectus, slight differences between them. The Neanderthals being a little larger than the Homo erectus might be explained as just something due to that. Just two distinct populations came out from the Ark and developed into those two. We do find them in the same locations, buried together on a few. So, same species. Based on our definition of what a species is. A species, most classical definition of a species, it's a naturally occurring breeding group that is reproductively isolated from other such groups. So, if a population is interbreeding, they're the same species. If you separate them so that they're no longer breeding together, you call them separate species, even if you don't believe that they will eventually merge again, forming a new population. But within humans, all the same species, all the same kind. Slightly different colors, slightly different sizes. Some of us are a lot stronger than others, you know what I mean? But, sorry, that was...
Cavemen and cave drawings. I mean, isn't the artistic expression human, or are there other human artistic expression human, or are there other creatures express themselves artistically that way?
Yeah, good point. I mean, we find lots of cave paintings in these Neanderthal caves, and we know of no other organism other than humans that are artistic in that way. That's a good point. And a caveman, what is a caveman? Is a cave, that phrase, does that describe a time? Or, I mean, if your house is destroyed right now, where would you live? You know, if there was a cave that you could crawl into, protect yourself from the rain the next night or two, would you do it? Yeah. I mean, when people have migrated around the globe, they seek out shelters, and one of the most obvious shelter, ready-to-go shelters are caves. When you migrate, you're going to find a cave, you know, especially if, like us, you don't have a backpack full of tarps and stuff. It's not a matter of when, it's just a matter of where. When you migrate, you seek out a cave, and there's no more mystery to it than that. People are going to live in a cave until they develop some better suitable habitat. One back there, Bill? Any more questions? It's okay. Let him get the mic to you.
I don't have a question.
It's okay.
But you just blew out everything I learned. I was born in 1936. In 1953, our science teacher had all these ones you showed, like how you put the jaws together and everything else. and we were so convinced that we came from them. And I just found this so fascinating because that's what I grew up with. And of course, I'm a Christian and a whole different outlook, but we were taught that we were really part animal. And I am so thankful that you've explained all that.
Thank you much. Yeah, that's what they teach. We are just another animal. They downgrade humans, they elevate animals, so you end up with a society like ours where it's illegal to kill a bald eagle egg, you know, but it's legal to kill a human. How do we end up with a society like theirs? You can't kill the bald eagle egg, but you can kill by elevating animal rights and degrade humans down to be an animal.
Well, wasn't David one of the cavemen when he was trying to hide from Saul? Where did David? He lived in the cave.
What was that caveman that was hiding from Saul in that cave? That's a good one. Any other questions? Any comments?
I used to hear about Cro-Magnon man. You didn't mention that, but he was what, Homo erectus?
Right. Okay. That was just an older name for Homo erectus. That's true. Cro-Magnon man.
I'm hearing among the diabetes people that they're saying now that they have evidence that certain of these genes for diabetes, you know, the most current thing, that Neanderthal shows that this is all very, very real, and the Neanderthal really were 30,000 years ago. And one of the biologists, doctor, even said, oh, now we have the DNA of Neanderthals. I thought, wow, anything on that? I mean, there's just no way you're going to have any genetics. It's only this outgrowth of modern, you know, of humans today that they use for basing all that growth that you mentioned, right?
To my knowledge, yes. I couldn't speak to that with any certainty if they found DNA from any of those specimens, but I wouldn't think it unlikely that you could at least get fragmentary DNA from some of them. Well enough preserved, at least fragments. Sir, did you want to bring it down? One more. Okay. Bill down here in front, one more.
This is something I'd like to get your reaction to. We're told that evolution takes so much time, the amount of time that it does, because of natural selection, the randomness of natural selection. If we shift to artificial selection, what humans do, they husband animals and whatnot, you'd think that we would have the equivalent of not 4 billion, but 15, 20, 50 billion years of evolution could be accomplished through artificial selection, and yet there is no laboratory successes in making a new species, much less a new genus or family. Really not even turning a freshwater fish into a saltwater species. So what, it's always intrigued me that the utter experimental failure of it doesn't count for more in the analysis of the theory.
Yeah, very, very good point. All of human experience tells us that animals change a lot, plants and animals change a lot, but they stay the same plant or animal. Darwin himself was a breeder of pigeons, was well familiar with what can be accomplished through artificial selection, and he was extending his experience in that area, and that's what caused him to come up with the term natural selection, basically doing what humans have done. But the finches are still finches, your pigeons are still pigeons. Most of us, young Earth creationists, are willing to accept a lot of evolution, that a lot of change can take place, but it's not by random mutations. God has created organisms with the ability to adapt, and it's this adaptation, the morphological functional changes that take place as an organism adapts to different environments, that is what they're calling evolution. But it is just an extraordinary ability to adapt. But the adaptation doesn't come about through random mutations. That's ridiculous. Random mutations destroy information. But these organisms were created with an ability to perform a level of self-genetic engineering. The chromosomes rearrange themselves while producing these sex cells. And it's very, very probable that some of those changes are specific responses to environmental needs. That it can literally tweak an individual to help them adapt in very specific ways. We can point to some examples of this, some organisms that we know that are performing genetic engineering. Bacteria are amazing genetic engineers, manipulating their own DNA to help them perform some really amazing tricks ecologically. But still, that's all design, by design, that these organisms change through time. So, a good point. Any other last question before we shut it down? One more right here. Although I just said one more. That's not one more.
This is the old one about billions of years. Obviously, with the way they're working with evolution, billions of years has to be there. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it couldn't happen in 6,000-7,000 years. Mm-hmm. Right?
Right. If for mutations to have the possibility of making these causing these kind of changes, it would have to be very, very slow. Very, very slow. Any more rapid, and it would just destroy what's there. So that's one of the reasons why they need deep time for those kind of things. But interestingly, and kind of a side note to this, one study, the mitochondrial Eve data that I showed you, this migration of people around the world, and the dates that they assigned to them were based on assumed mutation rates. But later studies were done. I'm not sure why these dates haven't been modified to accommodate this study, but studies were shown that the mutation rates within mitochondrial DNA were much more rapid than they originally thought, shrinking these dates for this radiation event down to just a few thousand years, which is very interesting. So, but yeah, they need deep time. They need vast periods of time for the cosmos to form itself. If this Big Bang is responsible for the cosmos that we see, stars would need billions of years through thermonuclear fusion reactions and supernova to eventually have cooked themselves the big elements that would eventually become things like planets. Deep time is requirement for their theories. For these things to have formed all on their own, you require deep time. But God spoke and the universe existed just the way it is. In an instant, the universe was there. It's an amazing thing. Can I close in a word of prayer? Father, again, we just thank you for your word and the tremendous insight that we gain from it, Father. We just want to lift you up one last time and worship you, Father. Thank you for the knowledge that you permitted me to share. And we just ask for open minds and open hearts and for a longing to and a deeper knowledge of the science that supports the Bible, Father. I just ask that you bless these people, help them to retain the information that they have, point them in the direction of some more knowledge that they need. Give them an opportunity to serve you, Father. Give an opportunity to witness for you. Father, we love you so much. Bless us and multiply us, Father. Father, we lift you up and we praise you and we glorify you. Glorious is the name of the Lord God Almighty. Worthy of him is our praise, Father. Father, we love you. We worship you. In Christ's name we ask. Amen.